Here's what I did with the Torrent browser bundle. Since yesterday I actually decided to just try it out a little bit, because there's some pretty neat configuration changes to Firefox and stuff like that. And so it turned out to be a really interesting experience. Basically, it's all self-contained. It's just, you can just basically extract the package somewhere and just run it. And that's pretty cool. So for me, I was wondering how could I basically protect it or confine it a little bit without too much work, because Firefox is a graphical user interface, so it has a lot of communication with X Server and stuff like that. So what I basically decided to do was to see if I could run it in with the Sandbox application. Basically, Fedora ships Sandbox, which is an application that allows you to run applications in a predefined sandbox. So I was basically looking at running the browser bundle in the Sandbox web domain. Now, it quickly turned out that it wasn't working by default, obviously, because if you actually look at the I basically extracted the package in Mount Crypto and then grab what is it, Tor browser and US, I suppose. So, but basically, when you extract that in, for example, I basically sent that back to Mount Crypto, and then extracted it there, and that's basically what you got. Now, without the SLinux context, obviously, the SLinux context initially was just user home T there for me. Now, I tried to run it, didn't work. And so I started looking at AVC denials, obviously. I found out, okay, it's self-contained. All the libraries needed are in there, and all the executable files are in there, configuration files and whatnot. So first thing I did, because I already had it in my mind, okay, I'm going to just use it for try to use it for the sandbox. So the first thing I did was I basically properly classified the files that were in there. And so I started basically by classifying the files using a couple of types that I had. Basically binti, libt, sandbox file t, etct. Globally, those are, I guess, the types that I basically use it. So, for example, if the file needs to be executed, then it's going to be binti. If the file needs to be mmapped, for example, library files, then it's going to be libt. If a file needs to be read, then it's going to be etct. And if a file needs to be written to, or a directory needs to be written to, then it's sandbox file t. As you can see here, basically the top level directory Tor browser and US is labeled with sandbox file t, because basically when you run this application, the user home directory is set to this directory. So that's why you see the cache and config directories in here, because then usually those all end up in your home directory, and since this is your home directory, it's ending up here. And same for the ESD out, which is basically your Pulse Audio authentication or ESD authentication file or something like that. And so basically that's the top level domain. If you look at below stuff there, then I'll just do one example, data. So we have the same. So basically I'm only labeling the stuff that is applicable. So for example, in this case, browser, directory that's not written to, so that's just states user home t. I just didn't do anything with that. The user home t is a default type for this location. It's what it was before I started this endeavor. And this is the Tor. Now the file context specifications for this solution are really pretty ugly. So here you have, for example, a bunch of stuff that's labeled with etct, or one geo IP is etct, and then you have stuff that's labeled with sandbox file t, and then you have here the only exception, which is basically the Tor RC files. Now these files need to be renamed. Previously I had them etct, but they need to be renamed by Tor, and so I decided to give that a private type. So that's the only place where I decided to give them a private type, but Tor can still only read them and rename them, these two Tor RC and the Tor defaults. So yeah, that's basically how this is set up, and the file context file, and I'll show you a link where the policy that I use is really messy, because usually you can use regular expressions to group file context specifications, so to speak, but that didn't work here, and that's I'm not sure whether that's due to a bug in how the SELint script sorts the file context specifications, or whether it's just because of my setup, because, well, I'm using a pretty exotic configuration here. But anyways, it turned out that the easy way didn't work, so I had to basically specify every single file that is installed by this package, or extracted by the package. And basically, I need to actually explicitly define all the stuff that the browser writes, and that's basically impossible. So that's why this is basically a work in progress. But this is at least the basic stuff. It makes it work in the basic sense. And then basically, I also have written a script, which is a lousy script, and it's still not working. My Tor B. Oh, let's open that in English. Emacs. Basically, the idea of the script is, okay, before you try to run Tor, see if that location is actually mounted, which is mount crypto, which is basically my dev mapper crypto thingy. And so if that's mounted, then okay, run a sandbox with the X for graphical user interface, M for temporary user and temp directories, and then with the sandbox web T type, and then run mount crypto Tor browser, start Tor browser. And then after that, I'm basically having a hack here, which currently seems to not work. So basically, I'm trying to find all the PIDs, process IDs of Pulse Audio processes that run in the web, sandbox web client T domain. And then I'm trapping the exit, so as soon as this, the browser exits, I want those PIDs to be terminated. Because a sandbox leaves dangling Pulse Audio processes hanging. And this is basically a way, at least I was hoping, that this would be a fix for that, so that I don't end up with Pulse Audio processes from old sandbox instances. But it seems to not work. At least it doesn't crap out, but for some reason sometimes it doesn't actually do anything. It doesn't kill the process. So let's just try it out. So my Tor B. Let's just run it. Now, as you can see, there's some weird stuff going on here. The screen, you have this black bar here for some reason. I haven't figured out what that is all about, but you can actually just resize the browser inside this window. So I guess the window, size is not as big as the as a browser size, but you can resize it manually, so no harm, no foul. And as you can see, it's set up properly, it's configured properly, and I can just get my IP address here. And I have an IP address of this IP address, and congratulations, it's configured. And then, for example, let me just do one thing to show you that it is actually confined, because there's some weird stuff though, I have to admit. So here I'm saving the browser of saving a picture as, and as you can see, it goes to the Tor browser directory, desktop directory, as its home directory. So basically it doesn't go to your normal home directory, it goes to your home directory inside your Tor browser directory. And then you could actually save that image here, because this directory, I made that writable by the container, and so it'll be able to do that. But for example, if you go to home, you actually see the file system as the way container sees it. Now if you go to home, then you can actually see that there's nothing there in a home Joe. And that's probably because of how the temporary directory is mounted. So you don't have to worry that the sandbox process can mess or can actually see your home directory. So that's pretty safe there. Now let's see, how about temp? Temp, same thing. So temp, it only sees its own pulse audio socket or pulse audio directory. So let's just cancel that out. Because if you look for example, let me just temp this here. And you see that there's actually much more in there. But you see the sandbox home and temp directories. That's basically your sandbox. So if I'm currently, let me just grab the sandbox processes here and see. We have here, for example, the directory for 370.772. So ps aux grab sandbox. And that's actually the sandbox there, what you see here. We should actually less that. So yeah, the stuff is in the temp directory, and here you see the actual process is running in the sandbox. Let's see what we have. Here. It's a little bit hard to read this stuff. First one is where it runs the sandbox. Second one, I guess, as well, and then the third one, it actually goes to the sandbox web domain, and this is basically, yeah, still that shell script, that sandbox shell script. Then the fifth is the zapper executable file, and then we have bash, and then we have Python, and then we have some more shell scripts, shell stuff, pretty ugly. And we have sandbox RC that's getting stuffed, OpenBox, Tor browser, I don't see Pulse Audio. Is that just me, or? Oh yeah, here's Pulse Audio. And you have a lot of other stuff, DVFS and stuff like that, mission controls. Oh, actually mission controls not for the sandbox. Or is it? Yeah, it is actually. So yeah, there's a bunch of stuff running inside the sandbox here. So, but actually, Pulse Audio is running in there, so it should actually be killed as soon as I exit the script, I suppose. But anyway, so this works and this has its own private thingy. Now, some stuff doesn't work. For example, YouTube, some videos you can view, some not, because of there's no Java or what is it, Flash installed. And if you are using HDMI as I do in your monitor, then this will not, for some reason, Sandbox will not properly output your audio to your HDMI. So here you can see that Flash is not working. But some of these videos you can view them because they are not Flash, I suppose. But these are all. Jesus. Takes a little while to. Find one. Here's one. But there's no sound because the sound goes to my headphones. And let's see if that. There's actually no sound here either. Wonder why that is. Maybe it has to do with the screencast stuff or whatever. Oh no, it's because set to off. Yeah, and this works in the on the Mac. So. So I'll set it back to HDMI. So yeah, it works for the headphones, but it don't work for HDMI. So yeah, there's some stupid stuff there going on. But all in all, it's pretty re and here, this is another stupid thing. So if you want to resize the browser again, you'll have to actually take it, and it's sometimes it's hard to pick, and then just resize it. It's something you'd probably need to get used to. And I'm not sure if I can find a way. There might be a way to actually just deal with this properly. But just no big deal. It works. So yeah, that's it. So this is pretty cool. It's pretty confined. Except there's a minor thingy here that the file system is not actually compartmentalized. So I quitted the application and the script stopped, and now I shouldn't see no more processes here with Pulse Audio at all as well. Well. And of course, I'm wrong. Oh no, I'm actually right. It killed the process. Fine. Good. Luckily, fortunately. It killed the process. So that did work. But anyways, if you look at the file system here, for example, you see sandbox file T and then the DCD colon and then the S0. That means that it's not compartmentalized because the process was compartmentalized. It had the 771 something something something, but not the file system. And I'm not sure why that is. I don't mind because, yeah, for me it's not a big deal, and it might actually not work either unless I modify this a little bit, because basically it's. somehow the sandbox doesn't quite work the way it's expected. Because I basically said, okay, make the home and tender temporary. Now it seemed to have done that, but it uses a different home. It doesn't see that the sandbox home directory is reset to, what is it, Tor browser and US. So the sandbox thinks, okay, the home directory is just tilde dash home. Or what is it, it's just slash home slash Joe. Whereas sandbox has reset its home directory to slash mount slash crypto slash Tor browser and US. So yeah, there's some misconception there, but in practice it doesn't really matter that much, because I'm still using the sandbox home type for writable content and readable types restricted to readable and execute and mmap for the other content, and it still doesn't have access to the home directory of the user, so I still don't have to worry that a compromised web browser can mess with my GPT file, SSH file, or other sensitive information in my home directory. So yeah, there's a lot of weird things going on, but other than that, it's still pretty restricted. So I'm pretty happy with it. Let's see if there's some ABC emails. No, it's enough. So yeah, I made it pretty clean. Let's see if what happens if I restore gom rv mount crypto Tor browser and US. It shouldn't reset anything, and but you will get spammed with a lot of messages. At least see restore gom warning. Don't reset. So it doesn't reset anything. No default label. That's expected. That's because I told it to ignore these directories and this content. So let's see if it tries to reset anything. It shouldn't. Now, of course, I haven't actually used the browser yet that much. I haven't actually saved, for example, a bookmark or saved a file. And if you do that, then there's probably going to be, if you then after that do a restore com, then probably some stuff is going to end up mislabeled. So yeah, that really sucks, but I'm not going to use this browser for anything static, so to speak. No, I'm not going to save anything inside that browser. I might save a file that temporarily, but for that session, for the duration of that session. But I'm not going to save any bookmarks in there or anything like that. That's not how I'm going to use it. It's just for quick sessions that I want to have some extra privacy. And if there's anything else, I'll just use a normal web browser. So let's have a quick look at the code, I suppose. So I have the bookmark here. This is just a normal. It's in my modules, and you can look at the commits, and then the last four commits are with regards to the browser. And the first commit has the hugest, the biggest bunch. So as you can see, the most work is in the file context file. I'm basically mapping almost every file in there, every file and every dir that is installed is mapped. I'm telling SE Linux for each file how to treat it, and that's the ugly thing about this module, because if I use regular expressions to group these group some of these mappings, then for some reason it doesn't apply, and so that makes it a lot harder for me to, and with some exception, because here I'm using actually a regular expression and that actually is getting caught, so there's some weird exceptions there, Well, I just, at some point, I just decided, okay, let's just map every single file in there so that I can get it over with. And then later on, I might have a look and see if I can group some stuff. So basically, everything is mapped. As for the rules, it's really, really pretty primitive to make it work with Sandbox. I had to make some modifications. So what I basically did, and there's a lot of approaches to this, you could basically create your own Tor sandbox and base that on the web sandbox, the existing web sandbox. But in my case, I just added a, I just expanded the existing web sandbox and added a boolean where I set sandbox Tor browser, and that's set to true by default, and that all basically allows some extra rules. And the rules that are allowed extra is it allows the web client to list user home content directories. So that is there's some user home type dirs in the Tor web browser directory, and this will allow it to list it. Not a big deal. And it can already traverse it, and this will allow it to just list it. It's not a, to me, it's not a big deal. There's no sensitive information there, I suppose. And then you need to actually allow the client to connect to some pockets, sockets, or actually bind to the Tor port, which is 1991. I actually had to label that port with SEManage. By default, it's a unreserved port. So, so I basically had to label, and I think it's 1991 or, but it's at least a Tor port, because the first thing I did was I looked it up, and it turned out to be a Tor port that was not currently in Fedora policy labeled as a Tor port. So I basically, the first thing I did was label that Tor port type, and then allowed that client to bind to that Tor port type. And but it's not open in my firewall anyway, so. And then basically I need to allow it to connect to some ports here, POP and web SM, and these are related to some extra functionality. At least this one, this POP port, is related to I think it's Rise Up or some service that allows you anonymous connection to some service or something like that, and that's why I had to allow, or had to allow it, I allowed it. I saw some ABC denials and I thought, okay, what the heck, let's just allow it. But you might actually be able to silently deny these two, I suppose. Node bind, you need it because of the name bind here, so that's okay. And then it wants to set resource limits. And this is actually required, because else it won't properly start. And then here we have that rule that allows you, or allows the sandbox to actually read and rename that sandbox RC, those sandbox RC files. Because basically in the beginning it was user home T, and then I had to actually allow sandbox to rename user home T files, and I thought, no, I'm not, that's not going to happen, or etc T. And that's not going to happen, I thought, so I had to actually create a new type, which I did here above, and create that and make that type of files type, and then just label the associated type with the TorRC and TorRC default and whatever files, and then just allow it to read that and rename that. So now it's allowed to rename only the TorRC file, and that's basically the whole thing. Basically, load that up, run restore com on your directory. You need to actually change the path, of course, obviously, here, because I extracted it in Mount Crypto. You'll probably extract it somewhere else. But yeah, just keep in mind that how it works with regards to sandbox instantiating your home and temp. Tor browser bundle, setting your home directory to the root of the Tor browser NUS directory. So I'm not sure if it's going to work, or it's a good idea if you just extract this to your home directory and then use this solution. That's actually not a good solution at all, because you can't actually add these home context file context in your home directory. So yeah, if you use this, then you shouldn't install this browser bundle in your home directory. Put it in some custom mount point or something like that, but not there. So yeah, that's basically all that had to be done.